Okay, in this problem, we're dealing with a liquid phase mixture of acetic acid and acetone that's in equilibrium with its vapor, and we're going to do a few calculations having to do with the vapor-liquid equilibrium. All right, and so first it's useful to actually draw out this situation onto a phase diagram. Okay, and so in this problem, we have a set temperature of 100 degrees C. And we therefore might want to plot a phase diagram at variable pressure, right, and composition. And we'll do this for component one, since this problem asks about the acetic acid. Right, and this diagram I've already sketched a certain way. Right, so we notice that as the composition of acetic acid increases, the pressure decreases. Right, and so the pressure for equilibrium decreases. Right, and so this indicates that acetic acid is the less volatile component, and so this we expect to correspond to the saturation pressure of acetic acid, and conversely, this is equal to the saturation pressure of acetone, which is the more volatile component. Right, and so at the pure component, so at x equals 1 and x equals 0, we expect that the pressure of the system will be equal to the saturation pressure at vapor-liquid equilibrium. Right, and so when we draw the diagram this way, the higher pressure side of the equilibrium region is the liquid region. The lower pressure or less compressed side is the vapor. And then in between, we have vapor-liquid equilibrium. Right, and we'll start plotting some points here. And we're just going to do this in a qualitative way to see where we are. Right, but we know that initially our liquid composition is given as 0.4. And so we know that our liquid, which is described by the top line here on our two-phase region when it's in equilibrium with its vapor, we can describe its composition and its pressure by a point right here. Okay, and so now the first question is to determine the fugacity of the acetic acid. And we're told we can assume ideal gas and ideal solution type behavior. And so therefore, we can say that the fugacity of component one, right, if it's ideal solution, then we can assume Raoul's law for the liquid phase and say that the fugacity for the liquid phase is equal to x1, or the mole fraction in the liquid phase of component one, times the saturation pressure of component one. And if we want to know the saturation pressure, and we know this is a function of temperature only, all right, and we already know the temperature, which is 100 degrees C, right, then we can use an Antoine relationship. So we'll raise to the power of 10 the quantity A minus B over T plus C. And then we have values for these A's, B's, and C's that you can find in the back of most textbooks. And so for component 1, or acetic acid, we have A is equal to 8.021. B I find to be equal to 19.36.01, and then C we find to be 258.451. Okay, we can plug in these values at the known temperature again of 100 degrees C, and if we plug those in, and this you can find when you look up your relations for Antoine coefficients, that you actually use temperature in degrees Celsius for the numbers that I have here, that P1 sat is equal to 0.55 atmospheres. I'm keeping track of things in atmospheres. And what the direct output of this calculation is in terms of torr, or millimeters of mercury. And so it's equal to 417 torr. Okay, now to find the fugacity, we simply have to multiply by the mole fraction. So we take that P1 sat, multiply by 0.40, and we find that the fugacity of component one in the liquid phase is equal to 0.22 atmospheres. And I say that that's the fugacity of the liquid phase, but of course, at vapor-liquid equilibrium, we had the fugacities for each component in each phase should be equal. Right, and that's what we're dealing with here. So this is just the fugacity of component one. Right, we'll see that it will be useful for a subsequent step of the problem to determine the fugacity of component two, or at least the saturation pressure of component two. And so P2 sat is again equal to this same relationship, but with different values for the constants. And I'll go ahead and write those down quickly here. Okay, so those are the values of A, B, and C. And then P2 sat, if we just plug in those numbers along with T equals 100 degrees C, and then we calculate the saturation pressure in torr and then just do a straight unit conversion to atmospheres, which turns out to be 3.59 atmospheres. So component two is quite a bit more volatile than component one. All right, and so now we determine the fugacity of component one. That's not something that we often would plot on a phase diagram. Right, fugacity, of course, isn't a truly measurable concept. It's just a useful concept for computing phase equilibria, as we'll see. All right, but what we're going to determine in part B is the pressure at which a liquid will be in equilibrium with its vapor at 100 degrees C if it has the composition of 40% acetic acid with the remainder acetone. So we're going to find the value P that is right here. For part B, all right, we need to equate the fugacity of the vapor phase for component one to the fugacity of the liquid phase for component one. These kinds of fugacity relationships are really what allow us to calculate vapor-liquid equilibrium. And if the fugacity for an ideal gas is equal to Y1 times P, so in other words, the partial pressure of component one, and the fugacity in the liquid for an ideal solution, as we've already said, is equal to X1 times P1 sat at our temperature, which in this case is 100 degrees C. All right, we can write a similar relationship for component two, and we can then sum those up. Okay, and we can realize now that Y1 and Y2, if we have a two-component system, these are just the gas phase mole fractions of components 1 and 2, that they have to sum up to be equal to 1. And so we have that our pressure is equal to this sum of the liquid phase fugacities for the two components. All right, we've already seen that this is equal to 0.22 atmospheres from part A. And then here we never calculated it directly, but we have 60% of acetone in our liquid, or 60% of component 2 in our liquid, times 3.59 atmospheres. From that sum, we get a total pressure of 2.37 atmospheres. Right, so we can come back up and label our plot, which is again quantitative. Right, so this, we now know the pressure is 2.37 atmospheres. Right, we saw earlier that this pressure is 0.55, and this pressure is 3.59. Drawing is not to scale, but it makes sense that we find a pressure that's intermediate for this ideal solution, ideal gas behavior, between our two saturation pressures, as we'd expect based on the overall shape of this curve. Next, we want to move to part C. So we found the pressure by writing fugacity relationships, and we just use those again in a different way to solve part C. So we need the vapor phase mole fraction of acetic acid. And we see that now that we know the pressure, that we know P, X1 is 0.4, and we know P1 sat is 0.55. And so we can just take this with those known values and solve for Y1, which would be equal to 0.092. So a little bit less than 10% on a mole basis acetic acid in the vapor phase. And so this number we find to be 0.4. This number we find to be about 0.09 if we went down and plotted it on this axis. And again, drawing is not to scale. Okay, and so we've just found that composition in the vapor phase. And so then the final question that we are asked is, if we have an entire system, and we measure the mole fraction of the acetic acid to be 30%, how much of that total system is vapor compared to liquid? All right, so in other words, do we have half of our system that's in the vapor phase on a mole basis, a quarter of the system, three quarters of the system? And so basically the idea here is that we're told that the total system composition is 30% acetic acid. All right, and so that means we have vapor-liquid equilibrium at this temperature and pressure. All right, and we want to know how much liquid and vapor add up to give that 30%. All right, and so here's where we can use the Lever rule. The Lever rule is a form of a mole balance. We'll do this graphically. You can also solve this completely algebraically. All right, but what we will realize, according to the Lever rule, is that the fraction that is equal to the vapor is equal to the length of the opposite side, so the side that is adjacent to the liquid, that's what the lever rule says, divided by the total length of this line segment. Okay, and so we'll go ahead and apply this and then come back and look at whether this makes sense. All right, the total amount, total number of moles of vapor, divided by the total number of moles in the entire system, right, is equal to the length of that line segment that was on the right, which that line segment ends at an X value of 0.40, and it begins at the bulk composition value of 0.30. We're talking about this line segment right here. That line segment has a length of 0.1, right, and then we divide that by the total line length, which extends from 0.092 to 0.40, and we find the fraction of the total moles that's in the vapor phase is equal to 0.33. So in other words, if we had a mole of this 30% acetic acid mixture in the total system, then 1/3 of it at this temperature and pressure would be in the vapor phase, or 1/3 of a mole would be in the vapor phase, and 2/3 of a mole would be in the liquid phase. Okay, and so if we come up here, we see that that makes sense according to our plot, that we're at a 30% composition of acetic acid, we're inside this phase envelope, but we're a lot closer to the liquid side of the phase envelope than we are to the vapor side of the phase envelope. And that means we expect to have more liquid than vapor, and we see that we do by a roughly 2-to-1 amount.